He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave Explains.
Okay guys, today's practice problem is about nomenclature. We've got an alkane, we've got an alkene, we've got an alkyne, and a cycloalkane. So let's go ahead and give these the correct IUPAC name. And if you're having trouble with this, go ahead and check out. I have several lectures on IUPAC nomenclature. Okay, so let's go ahead and name these one at a time. Remember that when we're generating an IUPAC name for a compound, we have to do a couple of things. The first thing we have to do is identify the parent chain. The parent chain is always going to be the longest carbon chain in the molecule. So we have to be careful because we have a tendency to just say, okay, there's the parent chain, but actually it's going to be longer if we go up here. So here's the parent chain from here to here. The second thing we have to do is then number that parent chain. If it's a linear molecule, it's either going to be left to right or right to left. Remember that if all we're dealing with is alkyl and halogen substituents, which all have the same priority, we are simply going to choose the side that has the first substituent occurring sooner. So if we're starting over here, we have a methyl group on carbon 2. If we're starting over here, we have a methyl group on carbon 3. So that means we are going to number this left to right. So we're going to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So that's the first step. We identify the parent chain and then we select the direction in which we're going to number it. So now that we've done that, we have to identify all the substituents. So let's identify the substituents. We have a methyl there, we have an ethyl there, we have two fluoros, and we have a methyl there. Now, completely separately from the algorithm we use to number the parent chain, a completely different algorithm we use is the one to decide the order in which we list the substituents. And that is going to be in alphabetical order. And so what we need to do here is we've got an ethyl, we've got methyls, and we've got fluoros. So the first thing alphabetically is ethyl. So, and then we just list the substituents in alphabetical order where they occur. So on carbon 3, we've got an ethyl, so that's going to be 3-ethyl. Now, on carbon 4, we have 2 fluoros, so that is going to be 4, 4. We do have to list both of those. And we are going to say difluoro. First of all, that's fluoro, not flouro. I see that common error all the time. And 4, 4, we do have to list where both of those are occurring, even if they're on the same atom, so that there is no ambiguity. And lastly, we do disregard the prefixes in terms of alphabeticity. So difluoro still occurs after ethyl because it's F for fluoro, not D for difluoro. So E for ethyl, F for fluoro. And then next we have 2, 6. Dimethyl, and then we go directly into the parent molecule with no space, which is going to be an octane. So 3-ethyl-4,4-difluoro-2,6-dimethyl-octane is going to be the name of that one. Now for this one here, we have 2 functional groups that take greater priority over alkyl and halogen in terms of numbering. However, the one that takes the greater priority is the hydroxyl. Hydroxyl has priority over alkyne, which has priority over alkene, which has priority over alkyl and halogen substituents in terms of numbering the carbon chain. So we know that the carbon chain is going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 like that, but we're deciding to go left to right or right to left on the basis of the position of the hydroxyl. So we're going to number right to left because that will have the hydroxyl occurring sooner. Okay. Now we list the substituents, except for hydroxyl and alkene, because those are both modifying the suffix of the molecule. We will save those for the end. So what we've got a bromo group. B for bromo comes first. 6-bromo. And then 4-isopropyl. Now comes the tricky part, because both of the double bond and the hydroxyl are trying to modify the suffix of the molecule. So this is what we end up doing. We have to say, first of all, it's 6 carbons, and we say 5-hex-N. We drop the E on the ene because we need this E right there to indicate the position of a double bond or an alkene. But then we drop off that last E because there's more to go, and we say 3-all because we need to know that it is an alcohol and the position that the hydroxyl group is on. So 6-bromo-4-isopropyl-5-hexan-3-ol. So there's that one. Over here, we've got an alkyne, and we know that we're going to number this parent chain so as to have the triple bond occurring soonest. So once again, left to right, right to left, it will happen sooner from the right. So let's go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So let's realize that these are carbons. These are sp hybridized carbon. A very common error is to not realize when drawing an alkyne in line notation. We know that carbons participating in triple bonds are sp hybridized, which therefore have linear molecular geometry. So that's why we draw them like this. They have to be, in order to be geometrically accurate, we do draw them like this. So that is a carbon, that is a carbon. We have a 7-carbon alkyne, as well as a methyl group. So we're just going to list that methyl real quick. So that is going to be 6-methyl. And then now we list the presence of the triple bond as well as where it occurs. It begins at carbon 3, so that is 3-heptine. Hep because it is a 7-carbon alkyne, and then ine for the triple bond. So 6-methyl-3-heptine. Now, lastly, we have this substituted cyclohexane. Now, these are numbered a little bit differently than the linear molecules, if we recall, because it is not about left to right and right to left. With a linear molecule, we've got two options, this way or that way. But with the ring, this is cyclical. There's no given starting point. So the algorithm we use to number a cyclohexane ring or any ring is a little bit different. We are going to assign values to the carbons in the ring so as to give all of the substituents occurring at the lowest set of locants. So basically, we've got 12 options, right? Any of these 6 could be carbon 1, and then from there we could go clockwise or counterclockwise. So we've got 2 options there, 2 there, blah, blah, blah. So 12. We've got 12 possibilities. And so we're going to pick one of those 12 that occurs that gives the substituents occurring on the lowest set of locants. And so, for example, let's say we chose this was carbon 1, and then we went clockwise. It'd be 1, 4, 5, right? Or if we went the other way, it'd be 1, 3, 4. 1, 3, 4 is lower than 1, 4, 5, so that's preferential. But the lowest possibility is here. If we choose this to be carbon 1 and then go clockwise, 1, 2, 4 is the lowest set of locants. There is no other numbering scheme that you could choose that will have those occurring on a set of numbers that will add up to be lower than 7. This is the preferred numbering scheme. And so once again, because these are, so alkyl and halogen all have equal priority, so it's arbitrary how we, there's not one group that takes priority over another. If there was a hydroxyl group, that would take priority, and that would be carbon 1. It would be implied. Right, but here they're all halogens, so that's how we number it. And so then we just list it in alphabetical order. So that's going to be 4-bromo-2-chloro-1-iodo-cyclohexane. So that's the correct IUPAC nomenclature for all 4 of these compounds. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.